for the week. Oh, great. We got a note in the chat. I will respond to you in the chat about the cost for the lean conference. I think it's in the link. That's a great question. So I'm here. So I'm Katie Brown Johnson with the Evaluation Sciences Unit. And I am here to introduce the dream team of patient experience. This group is absolutely passionate around making sure that the patient experience is as positive as possible. And in particular, they're going to be chatting with you about the pre-visit experience and the work that's being done at Stanford around making the pre-visit better. Patients are obviously a major focus, but for all of the staff and clinicians that touch this. So Alpha Diaz, Justin Coe, and Rebecca Carey are our three presenters. I hope I have their positions correct. They just keep being promoted so fast that I can't always keep up. So introducing Alpha, she is our Stanford VP, VP of Patient Experience with Stanford Healthcare. We're so pleased to have her with us. Justin is her dyad partner. And in addition to being director and chief of medical dermatology, he is also an associate chief quality officer and physician dyadic partner to our chief experience officer, who may also be Alpa. You guys help me out if I'm way off base. And Rebecca Carey comes to us as really the lead and the brains and the brawn behind this project. I'm so excited to introduce this team. Full disclosure, the Evaluation Sciences Unit has been working with this group to support evaluation of these projects that they'll be chatting about. And I'm excited to see what more I can learn about these projects. I will turn it over to you guys to chat with this group for 20 or 30 minutes, and then we'll facilitate a broader conversation. So I think, great. It looks like somebody is gonna share slides.
Thank you, Katie. Yes, I am the slide share today. So if you bear with me, can everyone see my screen? Perfect. So excited to be here. Thank you, Katie, for the introduction. Alpa and Dr. Koh and I are thrilled to share our journey and some of our reflections that we have for you. So we thought perhaps I will go very quickly through the pre-visit work, vision and scope, but really getting into the meat of what we thought might be valuable for this group, which is really around lessons learned and how we're tackling managing change at the organizational level. So happy to answer questions in the chat and looking forward to the discussion at the end. So I'll start us out at the beginning. Alpa always reminds us that's the best place to start. And if we think back pre-pandemic, the organization and patient experience really took a hard look through some user research to understand the journey that our patients go through and the areas of opportunity and connections that we have. And what we found, shocker, we have a fragmented referral and pre-visit experience for not just our patients, but our physicians, our clinicians, our care teams, our payers, our community members, et cetera. And what we really have attempted to do in the next few slides is tackle how we fix that. And many of our patients experience us first and foremost through a referral to a specialist within Stanford from their primary care provider or their specialist in the community. The user research really called out some key areas of opportunity for us that you can see here, and there's a lot of background information, but the key highlights that I can call out for you are how we engage with our referring providers in the community, how we make it easier and to communicate with them and to get their patients into our systems, how patients manage that coordination of the care themselves and how we might be able to help them through that process. Where we have opportunity to make our data sharing across our own teams or with our patients and referring providers less challenging, less complex. And ultimately, what we discovered is within Stanford, we have different mechanisms and processes for our faculty team members or our Stanford Medicine partners, or even within our specialties, clinic to clinic or provider to provider. And as a brand for Stanford Medicine to be an integrated health system, our processes and foundations and our tools don't make it easy to live up to that and for our patients to navigate. Here's a visual of what that might look like if you are a patient being referred by your referring physician. This is a lot of touch points. It's a lot of back and forth. There are a lot of stakeholders you can see on this slide, and in each case, lots of time that it takes. So we do have our work cut out for us. This is not as easy or seamless or consistent as we would like for it to be. During the pandemic, if you remember, the user research was done pre-pandemic. During the pandemic, we realized, wow, there's a lot of pockets of work going on to tackle access and pre-visit and patient onboarding. And we aligned on some key focus areas and opportunities. One is how we connect ourselves and each other, our patients and our care teams to smooth out that experience. Two is the communication that we share between ourselves, our patients, what formats, what tools, what systems, how we make it more accessible and more clear to add value to that patient onboarding process. And then three, how we prepare our providers, our care teams, our clinics, our patients, and ourselves to make that visit and attending the visit really productive. We did establish guiding principles. We didn't just write these down and forget about them. We use them at every turn in our project team meetings with our management guidance team, et cetera, to ensure that we stay aligned to what we started out with, which was creating a seamless experience and staying connected to the user research and our end users and stakeholders, whether they be patients, providers, our care teams. And then just to give you some flavor of the work, our ultimate goal is to improve our patient experience and improve that likelihood to recommend that we can measure and create an easy and timely access to appropriate care for our patients. We had to break the work into some chunks that we could start to tackle as teams. And we have three separate programs. One is around the referral infrastructure, how that referring provider communicates with Stanford, how we make it easy for their patients to come into the system, how we move away from fax and telephone as our main forms of communication and use some of the tools and systems at our fingertips. Once we have the patient in our system, how then the middle bucket is really what we call kind of the meat of the work, how we improve the handoffs that we have for our patients and get them scheduled with the right provider at the right time in the right place with the right modality and not so many of those touch points as you saw on the overview workflow slide. We do tackle this work specialty by specialty. We've built out guidelines and infrastructure to help each specialty go through this process. And it does call out some harder conversations that we're having and where are the best places for our patients to receive that care. So this work is what's taking us multi-years. So we have 7 or 8 service lines scheduled over the next 3 or 4 years. And it requires a lot of interconnected work with different teams throughout the organization. Once the patient's scheduled, we really then take that foundational work and we're able to think about and be a slightly more innovative and uniquely Stanford on how do we collect data for our patients, from our patients? How do we use that to help inform the care they're going to receive with their clinician? How do we prepare for the visit in a way that is pushing more information up front? Can we gather labs and imaging? Can we have personalized content that's available for our patients to prepare for their visit? And then ultimately, how do we ensure that we engage our clinicians and our physicians and providers as they get ready for the patient visit so that the time of value really for the patient is the time they're receiving care from their provider. All the rest of this work is necessary, but we'd rather them talk about what their needs are from a clinical or care perspective than talk about how challenging and stressful it was to get scheduled for their visit. So I know that was very quick, but we do have a little bit of a video to help give you some context. that we shared at the beginning of our journey here in 2021. And I'm welcoming you into our circus of the pre-visit work and the pre-visit journey, and we'll start to share some of our lessons learned.
I don't care if I've got a referral or not. I need to get in and see somebody. My eye condition has been worsening over the last week.
Not until February 22nd.
I've seen several doctors.
Would be Tuesday, February 8th of 2022.
Oh my gosh.
We all know how difficult becoming a patient at SHC can be. Between getting access to care, navigating insurance complexities, and preparing for the visit itself, patients face countless hurdles along their care journey. Stay tuned to watch four patients embark on their pre-visit journeys. Will they achieve an optimized experience at SHC, or will they stumble along the way? Let's meet the players. There's a preoccupied juggler, values convenience and coordination, seeks collaboration with care team based on needs and preferences. Striving maintainer, starting to take a more active role in their health and wants to partner with their provider. Wants a shepherd through processes and system. Relationship builder, takes an active role in their healthcare. Prioritizes building collaborative and trusting relationship with provider. And diligent coach, highly informed, engaged healthcare consumer with complex care needs. Has high expectations of touch points with care teams. Here are the rules. Players will pull cards to reveal their next touch point as they look for opportunities to advance in their care journey. Inefficiencies will set them back in meeting their goals, but model line boosters will propel them towards a connected, precision experience and unlock key insights into SHC processes. Let's play! As you can see, Model Line's improvements turbocharge the patient experience and help them better navigate our complex healthcare environment. We can't wait to partner with you all to help us activate a better experience for all of our patients and care teams.
I think I'm going to hand it over to Justin now to start getting into the weeds with some of our lessons learned.
Yeah, thanks, Rebecca. Nice to see everybody on the Zoom together. And for those watching asynchronously after, really, really glad to have your attention. I love the opportunity for us to do things slightly different. So no run charts, no Gantt charts in this presentation. Really wanted to share some lessons learned over the course of the time that we've been after this. And what Rebecca just laid out to you, just scratching the surface of really what is it's a tour de force that she leads and has put together in terms of structure, process, flow. It's multi-pronged, as you can see, multi-year, multi-stakeholder. And if we just start to imagine the scale of what it is that we're trying to touch on and impact, you know, these are millions of visits, you know, hundreds of thousands of referrals and phone calls, you know, thousands of people involved in this. It can be really staggering, and it can be so overwhelming if you start to look in the details that sometimes it can be paralyzing. So what I would like to share maybe just for a few moments is how we use the concept and the power of storytelling to really bring this back into a core and really bring this back to a north, and how we use this to really engage people in the process. I think one of the things that we all know here as improvement enthusiasts and aspiring experts is just this paradox of change where every organization knows they need to do it. And yet how good are organizations at doing it? Usually pretty poor. And that paradox of, boy, you know, needing to change and yet unable to actualize it is something that I think that storytelling is actually a way to break through that and to resolve that paradox. Two main ways that we used the power of storytelling. One way that we used it was to do what we in patient experience have exhibited here as our core model here, where we think about three processes and three steps. One is listening. You know, we listen to our patients, we listen to our teams, you know, this grounded in real life user research at the heart of it. And then not only listening, but then using that to amplify and to communicate and to have other people step into the shoes. I love Rebecca's analogy of the circus, because if we think about the center of a circus really is the ringmaster, right? And when a ringmaster has an audience, imagine you're in the circus, they're not introducing acts by telling you the details of how thin that tightrope wire is and how high strung it is and how it's not braided, but it's whatever. They're not telling you the details of it, but they're really inviting you into a story and engaging not the logical part of your mind, but really sort of the side door part of it, and say, hey, you know, come with me, suspend your disbelief, and getting everybody out of their roles and into that sort of that mindset of a curious learner in the audience. Maybe if we could play the clip, Rebecca, one of the things that we did at the very outset was, knowing that, you know, we were bringing a really big issue, really big concept to people, and very overwhelming given the complexity of what it was that we're ultimately asking of folks. How did we get people aligned on this, on the same page to say, hey, there is something here that we need to collectively influence and do? And really it was to use the power of our people and our patients and their voices, and for people to get aligned and see that. So we'll play you just a clip. This is highly edited from, I think it was a, you know, maybe even a 15-20 minute clip, but just an example of one of the things that we brought forward into one of our very early MGT meetings, and just let that sit and let people sort of soak that in as almost an audience member in a circus, and to say, okay, you know, let's all suspend our disbelief and get around and put our roles aside. So maybe if we can play that, not sure.
You don't see what I perfect. See on my screen, then, is that correct?
Yeah.
You know, I gotta tell you something. I'm a Stanford graduate, and I've just started coming to Stanford Health, and I am just vastly underwhelmed by Stanford. It's mind-boggling to me that my own institution that I went to school for can't actually do anything correct here. I mean, that doesn't make any sense, right? Stanford University is ground zero for the high-tech revolution of the world, the entire world. We have a Stanford medical facility that can't seem to allow you to see the same damn screen that I see. All right, so basically, why do I have a duplicate, what appears to be a duplicate referral? There's no way for you to understand this and see it and tell me anything, because your screen doesn't give you access to that. Another thing, why the hell do I get your phone number to talk to you so that you can tell me, well, there's somebody else you can talk to, and then when I go to them, they're going to say, well, we don't really handle this. Go back to a patient referral, and they should be able to handle it for you. Holy feck. This is what I'm talking about. Incredibly, the worst health system I've seen ever been a part of. Why on God's earth do we hire people for positions like yourself and give you nothing to help us? So there's yet another layer, and now we begin to wonder why healthcare in this country is so fucked up, expensive.
Yes, I will go ahead and get you connected to them directly.
Should have gave you the trigger warning there. Imagine yourself sitting in a meeting and hearing that and saying, okay, it's hard to hear one, but it's also very powerful, and it's very unifying, and it's very it draws everybody into the same space and the same page. And I think it was amazing what that clip did when played in front of that group of leaders. Really, the two things that stood out to everybody: one, boy, we've got to own that. We've got to own that complexity. We've got to own what it is that we're putting our patients through, the work and the friction that we're asking them to undertake in order to get their care here. So everybody had to face that and see that. It's almost like this concept of bearing witness. You can't look away, it's in front of you. And then the second reaction was, we're also failing our team members, which is a really powerful one as well. Look at what we're doing and putting in the harm's way our team members, because we haven't empowered them, because we have a system that's complex, that's broken. And that concept of, hey, you know, We're doing it for the patients, yes, but we also have a responsibility to the people who we work with and work through. that this is also broken for them. And I think that was one of the really most effective things that we did to start this journey. And we bring it up and we use it along the way. Every time we get off track or things get complex or we get spun up in the details, we really draw it back to the patient, to our teams, and what it is and why it is that we're doing this. The second way that I'll say that we use storytelling is also in a way where depending on the stakeholder audience, we paint a picture of what can be, right? And so we show an example of, yes, you know, it is broken now, but let's think about where we've been as an institution. You know, we got through COVID by standing up video visits, you know, almost overnight, right? What was the process of change that it took for us as collectively as an institution to do that? We've been through hard things, and what will it take for us, you know, to do this and to fix this in a similar way? And what can we achieve? And giving examples and showing people allows them then to step in alongside you and imagine, ah, you know, if only, if we could. And it takes them out of the why not and why, you know, why can't we? And so I think that concept and really finding those key moments when storytelling and using that method of entering the side door rather than sort of directly confronting the front door can sometimes really bypass that track of that logic, the numbers, the reasoning, the structure, and all the details that sometimes puts people in a reactive or a defensive mode, because it's safe. You know, the place where you are is safe, and change is hard and change is scary. That's one of the tools that I think we've used. Would love to learn more about what people have experienced in their work and in using storytelling and effective ways they've done that. But that's really one that stood out to us. So, Rebecca, I'll pass it back to you for the next lesson that we had.
Great. Thank you, Justin. And much like Justin shared, we continue using stories as we go through this process because it helps reinforce why we do work that feels hard. A piece of telling that story is socializing. And we have a bit of a running joke that I probably socialize this work with two or three key stakeholders or leaders or new people to join our teams every week. And I'm happy to do it because what it helps us do is ensure that we're on that we're sharing the same language, that we all have the same understanding. I don't know how many times I think this our leadership teams talked about just the concept of self-scheduling versus patient self-service in our MyHealth system. And there was a lot of concern and anxiety of such a small piece of the workflow that we thought fit into the big picture around, will patients be able to schedule whenever, wherever, however they want? And ensuring that we were all talking about the same things. We built a glossary. We uncovered differences in understanding about language and what we called things and what we titled things and how we talked about them. And that took us a really long time. And it led us down the path to pushing out more information through a website that we've designed or through the playbooks that we're developing and documenting our shared understanding or newsletters that we send out to all of our key stakeholder groups. And so while socializing could be one-on-one or in a group setting, it can also just be through clarifying and changing how we talk about things to make sure that it's well understood. We have a lot of different stakeholder groups, whether it's faculty or Stanford Medicine partners, our destination service lines, our ambulatory leaders, our technology teams, enterprise contact center. And so we had to make some pretty hard decisions about how we would have communication flow and how we would make decisions. We built a responsibility matrix. Many of you may be familiar with the term of a RACI, just to align ourselves on where would decisions be made around this work and who sat at that table. And sometimes that decision-making wasn't easy. We didn't have all the right leaders in the room, or we had to go and get someone up to speed or delegate the responsibility to a different group, and keeping ourselves on track and on task to do that, and relying on some of our early documentation and our ability to just sit down and say, okay, what are the problems? How do we engage together and ensure we're keeping up on our documentation, our shared learning? I liken it in our circus analogy, like the clowns who are always in between each of the acts, keeping you going, telling you a story, connecting you to the big picture, responding with you if they're watching the circus act that's happening. And so this is an ongoing journey for us, and we continue to socialize because we have new team members, new specialties, new leaders coming in and out of the work, and we continue to evolve and share that as we go as well. I think Justin, you are up next to talk to us about championship.
Gosh, this is so near and dear to my heart here. It's really the concept. I think it's about trust. I think there's that Apple launch event going on. I think about Apple and this concept of early adopters. This is kind of what it is that we're talking about when we think about champions, and even more specifically, I'll say clinician and physician champions. The work that we are spinning up, that we are asking to change, has such complexity. There's so much operational, so much logistics, but at the heart of it, it's clinical. And I think you need to have those clinical champions and folks who believe in, who can be those early adopters, who are willing to engage in that trust exercise. And in many ways, it's like a trapeze artist, right? To keep on going with our circus analogy, you got a trapeze artist, they're standing on the platform and there's a long way down, and you've got to trust the people, the teams, the processes. You've got to be a believer in the why and the reason for change and want to get to the other side. And I think those individuals, and we've had so many in our work, those are the ones who do a number of things. One, they bring the subject matter expertise from a clinical perspective. Second, they're advocates for the work. They're communicators of the work. For better or for worse, when we want to influence other physicians and faculty and clinicians, usually it takes hearing it from a clinician. And so I think that's another part of it is truly being a communicator, a champion of the work, standing behind the work. And then also it is truly getting down into the weeds and spending the hours having the discussions, figuring out, hey, for this diagnosis, you know, do we send it here? Does it go here? What's the pathway? How do we do it? And then at some point, it is truly stepping off the platform and swinging. And the other part that we owe it to our physician champions is to also build that safety net for us to say, hey, our processes have a way where we can, we know that things will fall through, but we have a safety net. We have a way of knowing what to do when these things go wrong so that we can tweak things, we can change them. And then I think that concept of trust, once we do it, once we have those champions, once they get to the other side, that momentum builds on itself because you can say, hey, we're going to bring you along if you don't mind to go and talk to our other specialty or service line and talk about your experiences. And it really is this snowball effect where I think we're at the point where we have a critical mass of physician champions and that experience and where we're able to now go from the early adopters to, you know, to the masses, if you will, and really start to change hearts and minds and leveraging folks who are really critical and core. That's not to say that the other stuff is not critical and core, it is, but I almost think of that as like, it's the body, but you also need the soul, right? And so the two together, they work hand in hand. And that's the role that I think our physician champions and our champions have played in this. Back to you, Rebecca.
Yeah, thank you. The next lesson is really, if you think about lion tamers, they take the king of the jungle and build, as Justin was mentioning, a trusted and aligned relationship. Now, I'm not saying our executive teams and leaders at Stanford are like lions or big cats that we have to tame and train, but we do have to have trusting relationships and transparency and alignment. And with our organizational change, this work started out as patient journey, we have this user research. Oh, we realize our tools and our systems are not as aligned as we thought they might be. And we had to bring some really hard decisions forward to our leadership teams. And in order to do that, we had to be very transparent. How does this align with our operational plan? How does this align with the department specialty annual plan? How do we ensure that our technology teams have transparency with what the work is, as they have a significant amount of those resources? And in some cases, how do we bring forward some really challenging discussions and decisions that we needed to make from change management or cultural shift? And so the way that we did that was brought forward analyses, much like we all do. What decision do we need? Who are the impacted teams? What would be the pros and cons, or what are the downstream implications of a decision going one way or the other? And how do we have enough trust that if we make a misstep or choose the wrong thing, how might we get ourselves back on track? And so we've really pushed forward some thoughtful discussions on how we tackle that and what decisions we make and how we then document them and communicate them in a transparent way. Because every decision we make shifts people's work slightly and allows us to think about even some upstream work that we could do to make those journeys a little bit easier for specialties as they go through this process. I think I'm going to keep us going from the lessons learned perspective. Evolution, obviously, what we did 2 years ago is slightly different, a lot different, in fact, than what we do now. And so as each specialty has gone through this process, we've learned, we've used our work team as a bit of a learning lab and developed some standards and guardrails and guidelines and made decisions that help us be better able to scale or to transfer that knowledge from one specialty to the other, whether it's dragging our champions with us or socializing or telling those stories, but really documenting and codifying what it is we want to achieve and how we might go about doing that to help continue down that journey of creating a consistent experience for our patients as they go between different specialties, different teams, different physicians. And the way we keep ourselves on track is by really having some success measures that we look at and look back at to make sure we're moving the work forward in the way that we set out to do, and then adjusting when we can't. And that's much like you think in our circus as the trapeze artists do. They have the safety net that will catch them, but they have to practice, they have to change, they have to evolve their act to make sure that it all works. And when one thing shifts or changes, they have to start all over again. And that's our work too, is we have many relationships and structures that keep us in place, but we have the trust that we're all in this together to improve our patient journey and how our patients experience this with us. Justin, I think, I do have a little exercise. If we have one quick minute, maybe I'll just pick the top two questions in the chat. If you feel like it, I don't have a poll, my apologies. If you think about this, would you rather live in the ocean or the moon today on this Monday afternoon? Or would you rather have the power of invisibility or flight? And if you think about how that fits in with your world, I don't see any in the chat that I can comment about, but I think I would prefer to live in the ocean rather than on the moon. It's a little dark in the moon. And I probably would rather have the power of flight just because then I could get around a little more quickly, see friends and family. But when you think about these would you rather questions, this is really how we're going through this work, right? We optimize our workflows, we're trying to achieve some consistency, but in every situation where we're navigating these scenarios, much like would you rather scenarios, and we're designing work and our approach that is adaptable to the needs of that specialty or that patient population, and using the design research, using our learning labs, using our playbooks to allow us to not only navigate this maze, but to improve and innovate at scale. Justin, I'll hand it over to you to wrap us up.
I think the reality and the truth is that what it is that we're really achieving through this incredibly ambitious large-scale project is we are fundamentally creating a different foundation. We're building a foundation for us to then continue to build on. So this is one of these things where we think about the saying of foundational is transformative, and that is absolutely true here. And in this foundational work and in this building and in this sometimes excruciating, sometimes fun way that we are moving forward, we are also ticking off things and making impact along the way. If we think about those three streams of work that Rebecca shared, one, this concept of how do we make that experience as seamless as possible for folks who are trying to enter or have their patients enter our environment. So the referrals infrastructure and some really remarkable firsts. And I almost feel guilty for being the one who gets to present this. This is the work of many people, lots of hours, most of them not mine, but things like, hey, first academic center in the state to transition to this open CIRM concept, open care referrals management concept, the ability for us to partner with large organizations in the state that allow us to be able to enter orders and referrals more seamlessly, the ability to do lab orders and for our referring providers to get notifications through, because all of these things are really remarkable and ones that can be invisible to us, but boy, are our referring providers able to see that difference and that's that timeliness that we're able to deliver because we're removing some of the bureaucracy, some of the paperwork, some of the faxes. Really is transformative, and you can see, you know, a kind of an in-process measure, if you will, or a proxy measure, just the reduction of the manual entry and the facts that is a reflection of all of that referrals infrastructure work. From the concept of, boy, when the patients enter the queue with a referral and their ease of scheduling, you know, that very sticky friction sand trap that we have. I'll just take a couple examples. One that I know incredibly well in our area in dermatology, about 40% of patients are able now to schedule their appointments without having to talk to anybody on MyHealth. That's an incredible efficiency that we've gained in terms of reduction of manual labor, the reduction of CRM messages back and forth, the reduction of patient messages in through MyHealth, their ability to see and get and pick and choose what they want because we've been able to streamline the number of visit types, because we've been able to turn on that capability by creating standard processes and workflows. So all of these things, they build on each other. I'll call out in neurology, a 4x, four times improvement in first contact scheduling. These mean, again, fewer CRMs between the scheduling center and the front desk staff. Fewer messages that our clinicians are getting from patients saying, hey, I can't get in. Can you help me do something about it? Fewer, again, people hours. So the concept that care experience and the ability for us to make lives easier for our patients and reduce their work also does the same thing for our care teams. That's a really powerful one that we want to continue to promote. And then in that last column, this concept that we're really sinking our teeth into as patients are preparing for their visits, what are all the ways that we can have them feel like we know them, we know who they are, we're thinking about them holistically, and by the way, we're thinking as a system. So stop, you know, asking, you know, for new patient questionnaires in each individual clinic that they go to. You know, you may be a new patient in cardiology clinic, but boy, you're known to us at Stanford. We know you. We already know these concepts about your past medical history. We don't need to ask them again. We'll ask you things relevant to your visit. But not the stuff that we already know about you. We've undertaken projects and things that again, you know, when we engage our teams, one that I love to point out, our GI team looked under some nooks and crannies and rocks and turned over stuff and identified that there was a whole bunch of erroneous lab orders that were available for ordering for LabCorp that we were able to remove. We're able now to really think about how do we gather the right information before a patient's visit to set up that visit for success. All of these things are happening in that column. And again, this is the foundational stuff where we start to think about if we can build this, when we can build this, what will that enable? What will that allow? And allows us to do the futuristic stuff that I think we're all excited to do. And maybe if we flip to that last slide, those are some quotes that really get to that concept of, all right, We got the tent. Now, really, what is it that we can do? Linda Wynn says, you know, the work of aligning quality and efficiency is really in this ability to upgrade the pre-visit process. Dave Speck talks about the concept of a consistent patient experience, no matter where a Stanford patient enters the network. Matt Eisenberg is really talking about how we can really tighten the partnerships between our referring partners and us so that we can enhance the quality and experience of care consultation that we provide. Laurice Yang is especially enthused and thinks that the work that we're doing with the team has been transformative, and these career-long issues, long-standing concerns are ones that where she's seeing movement on. She's able to lead efforts to address, which is inspiring and motivating. This is really the I love these quotes. You know, where the magic happens and where the impossible becomes impossible becomes possible. Would love to engage in the conversation with all of you. I know all of you are involved in leading efforts that are large, transformational, require this change management. And so we thought we'd bring a little bit of this slightly different approach of lessons that we've learned along the way and really engage in a discussion about, you know, how can we think as an organization in these kinds of things that we do to really learn how we bring about change better and more efficiently. And just want to take a second just again to shout out Rebecca she's the circus master. She's the creator of all of this. She makes it all go. So thank you, Rebecca, for all that you do. And you are what makes all of this work possible.
Thank you so much for that presentation. And we'll just give a round of applause. I think we definitely want to talk about referrer experience. That's a question that came up. But before we jump into that, I do just want to pose a question, moderator's choice. What can we do to help? So you guys have laid out this you know, big, ambitious project to revamp pre-visit experience. You know, what are the best ways, the ways that you guys need support? And then let's talk about referrer experience.
Nice, Katie. But before we jump into that, I was neglectful and wanted to invite Alpa to add on her any thoughts or comments or reflections before we jumped into that. I love that question. Thank you for teeing that up. Anytime a person asks, how can we help? It's music to my ears. We don't get that kind of question very often.
That is true. No, thank you, Justin and Rebecca. I can't say it better than how you both articulate it. And as I said in the chat, Justin and Rebecca are fantastic leaders who are kind and compassionate. And the stick-to-itiveness, I think, is definitely required. This is difficult work in a very large, complex system. So we have to kind of be mindful of approach and be flexible as our acrobats are, just to play on the circus theme a little bit more. But I love the question about what can this group and others do to advance the work and to really do everything that we all do together, right? Which is keep our patients and our teams at the center of how we work and how we lead. And maybe Justin and Rebecca, I'll take a first stab at answering that question since I had the floor. I think as improvement leaders and those that are interested in advancing improvement work, I think it really does come down to what we all kind of put forward every day, right? Really articulating what problem are we trying to solve? How do we stay consistent, to borrow David Speck's words, in that stay consistent in the experience for patients and for our teams. One thing I will say is, and you heard it on that phone call that we played, patients don't see us differently. They don't know the machinations of org structures and entity relationships that we all live in every day and somehow navigate. When they see Stanford, they see Stanford as a brand, as a trusted place to receive care. And when we internally don't create that connectivity, we start to erode the trust of our patients, as you heard on that call. And to me, there's nothing more sad or disappointing is when that happens and our proverbial sausage making gets exposed to patients and their families, and that burden gets put on them. And on the flip side, it's that same burden that gets put on our team. So how do we work together to define the appropriate standards, to work together across a complex system? Because at the end of the day, it really is about that level and that scale of improvement. So local improvement and local change, how do we translate that up at a system level, which is really hard, but we're not afraid. So Justin and Rebecca, I'll hand it back to you guys.
I'll just add on. I think my answer to your question, Katie, would be for all of us to reflect on the things that we can influence and have control over, the work that we do. What are the implications that it might have in the broader scale or for the larger organization or from the perspective of a person experiencing, you know, whatever that work is? What does it feel like for that patient, for that family member, for that team member to do it? And sometimes we solution by adding complexity because we think that's a better, more personalized way to do things, maybe without realizing that you have the complexity here, and all of a sudden you've created something that actually, if we think about it from the perspective of, did we do better by the patient? Did we do better by our teams? And did we do better by Stanford Medicine? The answer might be no. And so I think it's the awareness and just asking and the thinking. And I didn't start this way, but I've certainly come around to the idea that, you know, there is something profound about simplicity, and simplicity is what enables a lot of, if we strive for simplicity, that enables and requires creativity and actually can be unlocking of things rather than constraining. It's actually the opposite than one might expect. So that's how I would answer your great question, Katie. Rebecca?
Yeah, I just reinforcing, I think when I think of your question, Katie, it's definitely about simplicity and consistency. So if we're in a workflow and we think, oh, how can we help improve this? It's how do we make sure that we have a consistent experience for our patients? I think many who I know on the line know that I see 5 Stanford specialists. Every time it's something different. Every experience is different. Even though it's just scheduling the appointment or just preparing for e-check-in or just filling out my new patient history questionnaire. So anytime we can create a consistent experience, even within our own specialties, our own spheres of influence, that makes this work a lot easier as we want to innovate and transform and change.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. Yeah, to keep it simple. And consistent replicability is super important. Seth, I see you have your hand raised, and I am going to keep talking about the referrer experience because I promised I would. So, Seth, ask your question, and then we'll kick it back to Justin, Rebecca, and Alpa for responses.
Sure. Thank you all for a great vision, inspiring presentation. It's a low-level question, but it's about that phone call. I believe that phone call was from the summer of 2021, and the issue was that the Stanford Referral Center could not see UHA referrals, and I'm curious whether that particular issue has been resolved yet.
It has. Thanks, Seth, for remembering. That was a few years ago, and that story we tell often, that issue has been fixed for our referral center team. They can see referrals. Where we still have a lot of opportunity is they can't always get to the right scheduling team. And so that's part of what this work helps us do, is align that so patients don't have to pick up the phone and call so many different locations to follow up on that process.
That's great. Very happy to hear that. Thank you.
And Katie, since you asked twice, maybe 3 times now, because I saw it in the chat too, our referring provider relationships and engagement, we have a lot of work in the referral infrastructure realm. And I didn't, you know, it takes an hour to talk about that one slide with all of our programs on it. I did it in, I think, 45 seconds. But we do spend a lot of time with understanding the shoes that our referring providers walk through to navigate Stanford on behalf of their patients, and how we can clean up things in our, whether it's in our Prism portal or Care Everywhere, or just even our referral orders, and some of the basic information and education that we give to referring providers, how we can make that more seamless. We spend quite a bit of time thinking about and talking with and partnering, not only with providers, but with our market development team and physician liaisons and others to improve that experience as well.
Thank you. Other questions? And you can feel free to come off of mute or put something in the chat, either one. If we have bright ideas, or if there are things that we're noticing that might be things to tackle either now or down the line, okay, send them to Rebecca, send them to the team. Fantastic. That is great to know. I think the piece that we've seen in some of our evaluation observations is having that link, having the clinician champion is super important, and then having some sort of direct link for folks really kind of cinches the deal. So that is fantastic. Alpha, please jump in.
So just wanted to comment and reflect on something else that we've also, Rebecca mentioned this in the beginning, which is we kind of orient and communicate repeatedly to many forums. So I think collectively, as we all work on projects and change in the organization, because improvement is change, how can we be the champions of cascading information to the right stakeholders? I think that is sometimes where we also see some inconsistency it's all of our responsibilities, right, to share information, to make sure our teams and leaders know what is happening in the organization, because the more informed people are, the better perspective they can bring to the problem solving, the better context that they have in bringing forward ideas. So I think that's another just reflection of some of the challenges and opportunities that we have, especially when it comes to large scale improvement across our organization. If I had a magic wand, or if a would you rather get 2 more days of PTO or fix our communication channels? I would say fix communication channels. I would give up my PTO.
Would benefit you in the long term. I feel certain that is a sure bet trade-off right there, as hard as it would be. Well, we have spent a lovely almost hour together. Again, there's information about CME credits in the chat, and information about the Lean conference in the chat. We thank you so much, Alpa, Justin, Rebecca, for your time. And we will see you all at the next SMCI lecture. Have a wonderful Tuesday.
Thank you.